Good afternoon and welcome to the first Better Staffs Forum of this academic year. I'd like to introduce myself. My name's Alex Dias. I chair the Better Staffs Forum. I'm also a student here in FCES. For those who haven't attended the Better Staffs Forum before, I'd just like to very briefly run through the process. So the Better Staffs Forum is here to serve our students, and it's a vehicle of change. So where a valid suggestion is brought forward for changing something on campus, this is the opportunity for that idea to be put forward, to be considered by a group of students, and should the Better Staffs Forum approve an idea, it's then allocated to one of our trusted elected members who then take it forward to the university to bring about that change. Very happy to welcome a big audience here today, and we've got some very important points to discuss. So if I can move straight on to the running order for today's proposals. We've had a number of proposals put forward relating to our liberation networks. So before I go any further, is Daniel Donnelly Phillips here with us?
He's
in a lecture. Okay, well, Daniel's put three proposals forward.
Did the officer reports first?
Okay. We'll come on to that later. Thank you for that, Margaret. Our officer update. Who would like to start? Go, Jamie.
Hi all, I'm Jamie Lee, I'm this year's president. So each of us will do just a brief update of the key areas we're working on. We thought we'd go with three so we don't bore you all to death. The first thing is, again, mental health. So last year was more around the stigma, so making sure the students don't have a stigma against mental health and ensuring that they feel comfortable to be here. This year is working with the university to ensure that the services are up to the level that we need. So if students do need help with any type of mental health issue, that we've got the right facilities and services there for students. So a lot of that will be behind the scenes, but we will keep you updated with blogs and blogs about how we're getting on. And hopefully you'll see an improvement this year with access to facilities. But the university are being great this year. They really understand that it is necessary, so it's really good news. Second one is Ask for Help. So last year, Emma, one of the vice presidents, she did the Ask for Help campaign, where we went into lectures, spoke to the students, gave them a little checklist of who you should speak to if anybody's struggling. We're doing that again this year. We'll also have stands. So this is not next week, the week after. And it's just ensuring that you're getting the right help throughout your degree. Because a lot of misconceptions is that if you're getting 64% on an assignment you want a first, you can't go and get support from the library. You can. They're not going to say, oh, you're scoring high, you can't get help. So that's one of the key messages. And just ensuring that people are using the services that we've got. The final one as well is we've got a lot of issues at Blackheath Lane at the moment. So we've got our nurses, students, paramedics, midwifery students, and I think they're feeling a bit isolated. So we're working with the faculty to ensure that they're getting the same experience that we are at Stoke. So they've got the same issues as us with car parking, access to facilities. So we're working really hard to ensure that they're happy as well. Little things like not having a kettle, it's quite a big issue for them. So they're easily solved. But we are working hard with them, and hopefully they'll be as happy as Stoke students are. Any questions on any of that? Thank you.
You're right there, folks. I'm Ben, one of the vice presidents for this year, and one of my focuses has been on the Be Safe campaign. It began a couple of weeks ago, however, I see it as a year-round thing. I appreciate that for some people at this university, it's going to be their first time away from home, and I feel a moral responsibility to ensure that they are as well briefed on safety as they can be. I know that a lot of parents would appreciate their child having access to that sort of information and knowledge. Secondly, and that it's taking up the bulk of my time at the moment, is my proposed advocacy system that works alongside the Student Advice Centre. The idea being is that if we have more resources through student volunteers, we can then have a greater number of cases seen to, a greater number of issues addressed, and in line with the High Five referendum we ran last year, we can then begin to start helping to address a few mental health concerns by taking workload and stress off of students. Lastly, but by no means least, I am beginning the initial preparation phase for varsity this year. It's a flagship sporting event in terms of how we present ourselves to our direct competitors. And I feel that it's important it works properly for staff. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, please share it up.
One question. With the DSAVE campaign, will you be redoing the footprints that go from Hanley to the university?
Throughout the year, dates we haven't yet quite decided, working alongside Simon Stone, our police liaison officer, to ensure that everything's in the right place at the right time. And that is top of the list at the moment.
Sort of just to add on to that a little bit, will there be something put and implemented in so that once, obviously, you know, the next year comes along and the year after that, that it still remains viable and kept up?
Part of my work is actually creating a sort of framework for how this campaign runs, so that anybody can come into my position, take it over and go, well, actually, I need to do X, Y, and Z, here, here, and here, and everything can run smoothly.
Any more questions relating to DSAVE or varsity?
Well, thank you very much for your time, Brad.
Thank you, Ben.
Hello, everyone. I'm Sweta Reddy, Vice President for this year. So we have a lot planned for this year based on the referendum we had during last year's leadership phase. Out of that, the first one was mental health, and I'm focusing on employability. So my bit is very much academic and related to employability. So we have planned a list of events for our events management students, so they get the experience while studying. And that's creating an opportunity for them. And we are working on Life Hub for student staff members. It's just not a working on a bar or serving food. It's more than that. Giving them that organizational skills and any opportunities to learn new courses and something like that. And to start off, my campaign will be launched on 7th of November, which is when the Careers Fest is about to start. And Careers Fest is for 2 weeks, and first week is all about placements, volunteering opportunities, and talks from the industries, and there's some exciting stuff happening. Week two will be Global Entrepreneur Week. So it's another way, if you have any ideas and you want to work on, it's a better platform to go and meet those people who have done. We have someone coming, our alumni, who started this conversation in one of our quiz box, and now they're doing a national level, they have set up an enterprise. So there's some great stories to know. And this is us, whole officer team, we are working on clubs and societies, which contribute a lot for our retention and improve student experience. So I'm working very closely with academic societies, and Darren will be working, seeing the big picture for future years, how we can do it better for them. And we are still in the planning stage at the moment. And this employability campaign will start from the 7th of November and continue until April. So if you have any brilliant ideas and that can help students to focus on the career or something that helps to that contributes to this, please feel free to let me know. What else? So all this relate to my competitive edge. Is there any questions I can answer?
Any questions?
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Swag.
Hello, Paolo, and hello, our membership. I'm Darren, one of the vice presidents for this year. So some of the areas that I'm working on previously and continuing to work on. The first one is the Stafford transition. So there's been a number of problems that has come through for the Stafford transition. We did expect some problem areas to come up. The two main areas is the car parking, especially around Stoke campus. So we will be having a further discussion on car parking through as one of the better staff forum points. I am starting to compile a report along with our marketing team through all the complaints that we are receiving from students to get the main highlights. I would invite panel members to have a quick look at the report, and also members of the audience, just to see where we're up to. The plan of this report is to present to the Transformation Board on the main highlights of what is happening. I have yet to do a recommendation section for this report. It's still in the creation form, but I wanted to show you where I'm up to with looking at where student complaints are coming from. The other area for the staff review is the cabin facility, and other facilities on campus is facility access is a total past teaching time. So currently the cabin studios is my main highlighted area, is they are open from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. And the university tells students in their prospectus and the module handbooks that they have 1.5 hours of independent study a day. If 9 to 5 is considered teaching time, our students are currently not getting that 1.5 hours of independent study in our facilities. And these new facilities are quite amazing, but I just feel that it is not acceptable for the university not to let our students use it past 5 o'clock when they're paying so much money for their courses. So there's a lot of work going on with that. We have a meeting with Helen Chapman, she is part of FACT, to discuss access this afternoon. I brought Margaret Monckton from the executive to see Staffs TV doing their performance last night on their stream. She was quite shocked. First of all, she was quite appraisal of the students that they were able to set up a studio in our central area. But also, I highlighted the fact that we have a full studio over in Cadman that they can use, and they would not need to spend a couple hours setting up a studio. So that cabin work is going on, and it is an ongoing process, and hopefully we'll get very close to cracking it. The other area is affordable prices. So looking at the pricing of our venues, our shops, you'll have seen that club membership, a lot of them had drastically fallen in the summer. Myself, I've been elected on to the National Union of Students Directive Oversight Board for Purchasing. So that means that Staffordshire University students' views on pricing in union shops and venues is now is affecting every single student union in the country, through me relaying it through myself to the Director for Oversight Board. And the last area is campus vibrancy. So as you all know, Stafford closure would run less venue. So that means we've been able to put on a lot more exclusive events in our venues. You may have seen some of the lineup across the Welcome Week and moving in through September, October. We are booking more acts, more events in our venues. There are some exciting ones. Of course, I can't tell you what they are now because they're still a little bit confidential, but really do look forward to what we are putting on for yourselves. And I'm also working on with some of the team, Mark Spence, Scott Alcock, and Kate Rowe, working on a farmer's market. So we applied for NUS funding. We were successful for £650 of funding to put a farmer's market on campus. So we have now got to the stage where we've been accepted a license by the local council, and we are now at the stage where we are about to recruit volunteers and put in this final planning process of how that farmer's market is going to look on campus and propose our final date. Does anyone have any questions off the back of that?
No, don't say no quite so quickly. That was great. From the officer team, there was a huge amount of information there. So James gave us a bit on mental health. Ben's covered some information around safety. Swetha's covered about the employability that we've got coming up. And for Darren, the Stafford transition, very important. Car parking, very important. And access to our new facilities. So looking at all of that, are there any questions from either the panel members or the audience? No? Thank you very much. Got away with it, Karen. In terms of submissions and points to discuss today, as Fee or Daniel are yet to be with us, if I can...
Fee's filmed submission.
Yeah, Fee's filmed, so we've got that. I just want to try and give Daniel an opportunity to come back. Thank you for that, Val, yeah. So Fee's will be a video submission. But to give Daniel the opportunity to arrive, we have a submission, a proposal from Nicholas Hayward, who's one of our student union trustees. Let's say hi, Nick.
Should I stand up or...?
Fine, I can put the initial proposal together to the forum if you wish, or you can, it's up to you.
If you've got a place.
No problem at all. So, Nick's submission wants to discuss the feasibility of traffic calming measures on College Road. So, to go into that in a little more detail, Nick's submission. Since I'm aware that speed cameras can only be placed on a road if there have been three vehicle-related deaths within 3 years, he was wondering if it would be feasible to go to Stoke Council about having speed bumps, preferably slightly steep ones, placed on each side of the zebra crossings to force drivers to maintain a slower speed when passing the library. Nick has noticed that some drivers do not give way when students are about to cross the road, which creates concern with the possibility that a student may cross the road potentially with less awareness to their surroundings than some of us may have, i.e. listening to music on headphones or answering an important email, and therefore be struck by a vehicle and potentially at speed. In addition to the fact that this area is much busier now that most of our former Stafford campus courses are now held in the Cadman courtyard, he's spoken to PC Simon Stone about this matter, who has informed him that he has been considering the same thing and believes that the council are more likely to agree to this if multiple parties, which include Simon, raise this issue with them. Hence Nick bringing it forward to the forum today. So thank you very much for raising this.
You're welcome.
If I can, firstly, have I explained that well enough?
Yeah.
Got the point across, thank you. Any questions from the audience? Any questions from the panel regarding Nick's suggestion? General opinion? Can I, if we haven't got any questions, can I try and get a feel for opinion?
Good idea.
Yeah,
I agree.
Good idea.
There's
yeah.
Loads of times when I've had to sort of like step forward and step back because taxi drivers don't care about the course.
General consensus in the audience. I'm seeing quite a few nodding heads. And I'd really like at this point to look at our safety vice president, if that's appropriate.
It is appropriate, and as it happens, on the back of this submission, I received a phone call yesterday from PC Stone. It's something that he's keen to pursue with the student union backing, and pending a decision made here, I can already go forward with it.
What more could we want? That's lovely. At a very, very early point, much earlier than I think I ever have historically on any other proposal that's been made, I'd like to ask the panel if they feel as though they have enough information to make a decision on this proposal.
Yeah.
So if I could have a show of hands, please, if you agree we have enough information to move forward. Lovely, that's unanimous. That allows me to move forward to the vote. So if you support taking this proposal forward, and I think it's fair to say this will be allocated to our Vice President Ben Malbon, please show your hands if you'd like to support this proposal. In order for the proposal to be ratified and taken forward, we need 75% of the panel and confirm 100% of the supported proposal. Thank you for putting it forward, Nick.
You're welcome.
And thank you for the work that's already taken place. May I ask if Callum Holland is with us? Was Callum due to?
He didn't respond, so I don't know whether are you happy to present the proposal on his behalf?
He's put an excellent submission in, so I think it's quite happy to. So, Callum has submitted a proposal concerning car parking, specifically the communication or what he's described to be poor communication by the university with regards to students arriving and making the decision around whether they would bring a car. So if you could just, there we go. So the specifics of Callum's proposal is that the car parking availability and restrictions should be updated and available much sooner, or more parking should be made available. In terms of what he wants, the information on where student cars can be kept and the types of permits available in the upcoming academic year should be available much sooner. Applications should be open earlier, possibly as part of the accommodation portal, as well as the possibility of allocated parking spaces close to where your accommodation is. The other alternative is that more parking space is available for those living in university-owned accommodation. The reason that he wants this, it would provide students with more information and help them to decide whether to bring a car with them to university. It would mean that there is no worry about whether there'll be any spaces available and no worry about the safety and security of your car because it will be nearby. For instance, this year, the information on parking was not updated until we were already past Welcome Week. Students who had brought their cars from home have now been told that if they're in Leek Road university-owned accommodation, they can only keep their car in Claris Cliff car park. He feels this is limited in space and not in close proximity to all accommodation, and if there is no space, they must then park even further away in an area in excess of 20 minutes walk away from his residence and which is not actually owned or monitored by the university. If this information was available sooner, some students may not have worried about bringing their car. If a parking permit application or even an option to show an interest in bringing the car was included in the resident in the Res Life portal, for instance, then spaces would be allocated to students and or the university could get a better overview of parking requirements and could make arrangements accordingly. And this would avoid student disappointment. So that's Callum's submission. May I ask for any questions at this point? Everybody clear on what he's putting forward here? So we're not asking for, because the forum, we've had car parking issues raised at the forum before, and because of the nature of car parking as an issue, it's always been something that we've chosen not to bring to the forum. Because of our ability to really impact. But the angle at which Callum's come at this is more about the communication and the informing of what the university plans to do, especially at a time where there's so much change. If there aren't any, well, first of all, I should encourage more questions. Are there any questions from either the panel or the audience on this matter?
I live in Horse Residence and two of my flatmates have got cars, and if they go to Tesco, there's a park at Claris Cliff and then all their shopping back from Claris Cliff. It's like a 10-minute walk.
So they're having to over the bridge.
Yeah.
If everybody's not familiar.
With all their shopping right now.
And what problems do you think that poses? What are the more significant or areas of concern?
One's got a bad back at the moment, and coming in her shopping is causing extra pressure on her back. So she has to bring one of us, then she leaves Tesco. We have to walk to Paris to meet her at Paris.
Thank you for that.
Good.
So it's not ideal.
No.
Okay. Panel, any questions?
I've got one.
Sam?
At the moment, just based on what Val's saying, they've got parks so far away. If you live in Leek Road halls or houses, are you allowed to park in car park 1 or 2?
No.
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 You
not
have
to
park at
Claris
Cliff.
You've
got
to
fix in the right
circumstances.
But they don't tell
ticket,
you.
If you're on ticket, then you can park outside your halls.
They don't tell you when you apply for your parking,
yeah,
that it's Claris Cliff only.
I should
do that after.
And I should probably say it isn't really questions for the panel, based on your own experiences.
Oh, okay.
It's great for you to... No, it's my fault for asking a very specific question. If you've got some of your own experiences,
yeah,
you'd like to share,
yeah,
then please feel free sharing.
Well,
and equally, if there's questions around limitations to understand.
I was just going to say as well, obviously this Callum guy said that application has been relayed, and that is the case. I'm a master as well. We were told to sort of tell people, fair enough, applications were late this year due to one thing or another, but we weren't going to penalise until October. So fair enough, applications were late, but they were just, the university policy was, okay, let's have free parking for everyone until October to give people time to get their permits delivered to them so that they were able to park anywhere.
Even the decision about raising the prices and the confirmation was happening the third week of September, so it was late, it's not a communication.
I just want to make sure what Sweater said, because obviously it's okay, Sweater, because you're talking to us at the front. I want to make sure those at the back, it was the third week in September when the change in prices to the car parking. No, Darren's rocking his head.
Early August.
Early August.
The confirmation didn't go back because I had a student complaint regarding that. And when I had a chat, I knew, and that's where I was told.
I didn't know though until I applied for my parking that the prices had gone up. I was like from 35 to 55.
I didn't even know.
And then I was like, oh, well, I've got to pay it because I need to park.
Yeah.
Would you direct the university statement about the pricing? Because what the university has said.
May, again, as well, for the purpose of the camera and just for those at the back, Darren, can I ask you to relay this?
Of course.
That's lovely, thank you.
So, this is not my own views. This is universities. So the university, the vice chancellor has raised the prices to £55 through some benchmarking. We are still in the lowest 2% of universities that have a car park. So our price for car parking is in the lowest 2% of universities that have a car park. Our benchmarking includes local universities from Manchester Met to Kew, which include prices of £130 for the year. £550 for the year. So students at the moment are still paying less than, or just above £1 a week for the year, or thereabouts, or £1.30. Comparing ourselves to the other universities, we are still very low priced. I have had multiple conversations with the executive on the price of the car parking, and unfortunately it is an area that they will not move. If the panel decides that they would like me to ask again, I will. But I'm very confident that the university will not move on that pricing issue. But I am exploring areas for exceptional circumstances for part-time students and placement students.
Any immediate questions from panel or audience?
I don't think the prices are bad,
no.
But it's just the fact that you think it's £35, so you're like, yeah, it's only £35 on my student loan, and then you're paying £55.
So again, that comes back to communication to clarify, which brings us very nicely back to Alan's point.
The communication was really bad, because if I couldn't have my car, I couldn't come to university. I'm secondary carer for my dad, so I have to go home a lot. and it wasn't until the portal was open for you to apply for your permits that I found out that you can only park in Clarice Cliff and the prices had gone up and all that sort of thing. So panic stricken me was then running around like headless chicken trying to find answers. And I completely agree with the application that this has got to be done sooner. Because if I had known, I would have picked a different university.
Wow. Okay. Thank you very much.
Quite all right.
Thank you very much for that informed explanation as well, Darren. An immediate question that came up in my mind around the increase, there doesn't seem to be much rebuff against the increase or in terms of the 55.
It is a theme coming through the student complaints. So if anyone wants to read the piece that I am, you'll see that one of the highlighted areas, the first one, is cost. So there is complaints going through, and we do have quotes from student complaints on cost in that report that we have developed.
Lovely. There is a copy of the report, work in progress, that will be available for anybody just on the end of the desk when you leave. Or if you want one now, I can hand it around now, that's no problem. Personal observation from my side, for the extra £20, it would be really interesting to know where that extra income is being spent and whether that benefits the student.
I can give you a bit of update as to where Transformation Board is on car park, all the names of Blackheath and Stoke-on-Trent, if you like. So
if it fits.
university is exploring other parking areas within the local area closer to the university. Where they exactly are is still at a confidential level, so I cannot share with the audience because I'm no longer confidential on that. We have recently, the University of Purchase Fenton Manor to ease a bit of overspill. And so there is a lot of work going on with the car parking, but obviously with property management and buying, it is not an overnight process. So the university are working quite tirelessly on car parking, and a lot of the tends to be the top agenda meeting or agenda item in most transformation meetings. In regards to Blackheath Lane, car parking there, where they are currently looking at where overspill could possibly be. They're possibly with the new owners of the Beaconside campus, where the halls of residence used to be. We're possibly looking if we can have some form of agreement of overspill car parking there. So the university are actively looking into car parking, but we do implore student views and thoughts, which I do represent the students at the Transformation Board regularly. So if anyone ever has any car parking feedback that they would like to send forward to the Transformation Board, I'm always more than happy to do that for yourselves.
Thank you very much, Darren. Any questions related to the little update from Darren? No? Lovely. I want to bring this back to Callum's point now, and in a moment I'll be asking the panel whether they have enough information to make a decision. I just want to clarify it, really, to begin with, because there's a broader discussion that we've had. So the initial idea from Callum was that car parking availability and restrictions should be updated and available much sooner. We also put the addition that more parking should be available, and I think we're in agreement that that might be unachievable in terms of purely for the four. It's already been worked on as a, is it fair to say?
Immediately, more parking is not achievable overnight, but it is an area that the university is working priority on.
But in terms of the communication of that?
That is a new area and recommendation that we take forward.
So if I was to clarify the proposal, so it's to charge the university with improving its communication in relating to the availability of car parking for its students. Do we feel that that as a statement brings together this proposal well? Okay, and based on that proposal, does the panel feel as though it's in possession of enough information to make a decision? So if you would support the proposal to charge the uni with improving its communications in relation to car parking, can I have a show of hands for those who want to take this forward? Lovely. Thank you. And would you like me to charge this? Would you like me to assign this to, or would this be assigned afterwards to? Naturally fits there,
well,
doesn't it, really?
Yeah. Is that okay, Dan?
As said, the report's there, work in progress, so look forward to the next forum and see where we're at. Or lovely, thank you very much. So, our next proposal. At this point, I'm going to relieve Sam Pillow as a panel member. Sam's the gentleman sat on the end. So, Sam's proposal is around the renting of, no, stand at the, you don't get to sit, you're on show. So it's regarding the library DVD borrowing service, and rightfully so with the box sets that we've got. It's okay, it's okay. Just so you know, it's caught on camera.
You don't just stand.
There is a reason why. No, Sam, would like library DVD borrowing services to be improved. I can read your proposal if you wish.
I'll just say it.
Go for it.
So in the library, I've only realised in my third year that there's actually a really decent selection of DVDs, because obviously it's nice to just chill out sometimes and, you know, take your mind off your studies. And there's actually a quality selection of stuff, but everything's only available for one day loan. So I think the whole three times that I took out DVDs, and realistically you don't watch it on the same day. I got penalised and I got a 50p fine per DVD, which was kind of a stitch up. So I just thought to try and encourage a lot more students for using the selection, because obviously they're putting a lot of money into getting new DVDs, because they do get new ones, maybe encourage people to use them more by making it like a 1 week, 2 week loan.
Any questions?
It's not so much of a question as more of a support, that would actually be really useful for creative writing students and film students who sometimes need to take those films out to study them. And it's like, we have to like write it all up in one night, which can be a havoc because we don't sleep.
So we've got a change driven from a social perspective that potentially has an academic benefit.
Yeah.
Lovely. Thank you for that.
Can't you like extend how you do for a book?
So some with books you can renew it online, but with DVDs you have to be there in person to do it. So that's
Is it 50 pounds per DVD per day?
Per day.
Anybody in the audience? Any comments, any questions?
Maybe 1 week would be a fair amount of time, because you want to make sure that it's back in the library for other people to use it as well.
Nice. One of the things that popped out, because when I read this, I thought a box set. How can you watch a box set in a day?
Well. Encouraging binge watching.
So exactly.
So there is a Gavin and Stacey season 2 box set,
and
that's a two-day loan.
So, based on your experience, do you think the box sets need to be over a longer period of time? And individual DVDs might be. Have you got a rental period in mind, given the current?
I reckon from your comment there, movies, like straight up movies, 1 week, box sets 2 weeks.
Box 2 weeks and films. I'm just trying to get an idea.
Yeah, I reckon
that's good. What was it? Films for a week?
Films for a week, yeah.
And what does everybody feel about this? What are you laughing at? You're loving it, aren't you? I'm thinking I'm going to get my box set binged on now.
I have one question. Depending on the conversations to go with the library and the university, what would be the minimum that you would see as acceptable?
What's your minimum win?
Well, at the moment it's 1 day. I think that's kind of a joke.
So, minimum 5 days. Minimum 3 to 5 days.
Yeah, I reckon, yeah. 3 to 5 days, yeah.
I'm not sure whether you qualify as a minimum win, Catherine, but I'll go on. Go ahead. You do have to turn the camera around on yourself.
Basically, as a film student, I completely agree with the proposal. I think when you're taking the films out, I mean, looking back at, I don't know if any of you will remember Blockbuster, but they did a 72-hour loan for borrowing films, so if that would be a minimum, that would be a good proposal, because that is a service which were provided by a huge company until it went bust.
So are we saying as part of the, because some people may not want to borrow things for a week,
yeah,
and there may be some kind of, I pick up on the planning thing, if somebody else wants it, it's going to start to be used for academic benefit. We need to make sure that the provisions are there for all. So, do you want an option on how long you take it out for? And do you want to select that when you take it out? Or has it just got to be a flat period of time that you...
I think it's a maximum amount of time, but you've got to a time between 10
yeah,
and
9. Yeah, up to
say,
a week.
If you want to take after just 3 days, then you just bring it back after 3 days. Mm-hmm. But the period before you start getting fined, I think that should be a week.
What about an option to renew it the way you can books?
I'll hold my hands up. I've been that guy where I've just got a textbook and then renewed it like 20 times.
But in order to stop somebody renewing, the person who then wants it just needs to place in that request, and then once that rental period expires, you have to take it back. You're no longer allowed to renew.
It's the same with books. All you do is you just go back to the library, you scan it, and then you re-scan it to sort of take out. So if you wanted to do that...
I didn't think they would let you do that. I thought you had to return. It goes in the
box. Yeah, it goes in the red box.
Yeah, because somebody's already requested it, and then it goes to. That was my understanding.
Just saying,
we could probably do with a library person here who understands the processes a little bit.
Okay, alright.
But I thought if you have a book out that I want, I can go and request that. It tells me when it's out until, and the next time you go to renew, we'll say no. Somebody else has requested it.
That's
that was my understanding of the process.
That's
yeah.
Even better.
So we're talking about mimicking that renew process for the DVDs.
No, but there should be a minimum days at least for one person. If next day, if he asks for this DVD, I'm not going to return it anyhow.
That's exactly, at least I need 3 days.
So for a book, it's 1 week. So if someone has requested, you can have it for a week and then you can return.
Do we need to... Based on the conversation we've had, do you want to frame your proposal for us?
Okay. So I would like DVDs to be extended to have like the minimum period, or the maximum period of a week that you can take it rather than 1 day.
The minimum of 3 days.
Minimum 3 days, I don't know.
We won't let them know what our minimum win is, otherwise that might be our start point at the end of negotiation. So we want extended for a maximum of 1 week. And I want to pick up on this renew element as well. Well, it's not for me to want to, but on the renew element.
So we make it available that people can request the DVDs if it's
already out. Because we haven't got anybody from the library here today. Go on, sorry, Karen, go ahead.
Separate proposals that are going to take forward, so the extension up to 1 week is one separate item,
and
the renewal system is a separate
option to renew. Yeah, it's nice to segment. Thank you for that, Darren. Around the renewal, with us not having somebody who is an expert in our library and how it functions, and with that being a separate proposal, is it more investigatory at this point rather than actionable? Do we need to find out if it's possible, why it's possible, or what's the right way to go forward?
I would suggest an investigatory that could lead into action.
Because if it can already be done with books, the system's already there, so it would just be implementing it onto the DVD.
So that's why I would say investigate into with action.
That's exactly my thinking. Which then poses the question, why aren't we already doing it? So that's why I think it's potentially investigative, because we aren't experts in that area. There may be a consideration that we're not in a position to consider, if you like.
I think the library uses a different system. I don't think it's like an in-house system. I think they use like a second party one. Well, third party one.
As with books. Okay, well, I'm going to ask the panel if they've got enough information to make a vote on the two proposals. I'll start with the first. Do you feel he's in possession of enough information to make a decision on whether DVDs should be extended to a maximum of 1 week? If I can have a show of hands, if you do think you're in possession of enough information, thank you. So, to the decision, would we like the officers to take this forward to the university to get DVDs extended to a maximum of 1 week? Show of hands for yes. Thank you very much. That's a yes, Margaret. And that will sit with... Do we want to divvy it up or take it back to its natural point?
Entirely up to you,
Chair. No, I think it's up to our team. You guys know your workload. Who would like to take this one on out of the team? Sweater. Okay, so DVDs extend to maximum 1 week with Sweater. Thank you very much for that. In terms of the second, the renewal process with DVDs to mirror that we have with books currently, show of hands from the panellists if you've got enough information to make a decision. Yes, if you have enough information to make a decision. And would you like to support that renewal process being taken forward by one of the officers to the university? Show of hands for yes. Thank you very much. By nature that they sit side by side, so it makes sense for you to have both.
Yeah.
Comfortable? Thank you very much. Thank you for the audience discussion there as well. I'm going to move on to fee and Daniel's issues, incorrect proposals. Yeah, please come back, Sam. Now we need you. We need you.
Just don't knock it over.
Yeah.
The next proposal was put forward by Fiona Wood, one of our ex-presidents. The nature of that proposal is after witnessing a vegan student being told only.
Do you want me to do the? I was going
to
leave that one last. Do you want me to do that now?
There are some students who have to go early and want to.
Okay, no, let's do that now. That's fine. No. Stay where you are. That's fine. Is there anybody to put these points forward, Fee? Margaret, if there's people who need to go, or am I to put it forward?
Well, these videos and interviews, my understanding, so she's been interviewed by Ben about
the
proposal to spark off the discussion.
Okay. Right, Mike, are we ready to go with this? So we've got a 6-minute video now. Fee has put a proposal forward for a transgender network that operates outside of the existing LGBT+. So Ben and Fee got together, quick interview, question and answers. There's some key points in this 6-minute video, particularly about 2 minutes in. Any questions at any point, or if anybody's not sure, Mike can always pause it and we can stop kind of there and then, or we can just let it run through and have our discussion at the end. But Mike, if you'd like to start us off.
Hi there, I understand you're proposing a change to the existing LGBT+ network. What changes are you proposing as well?
The whole idea of creating this new liberation network is the fact that at Stats we've always been at the forefront of looking at change and how we can move forward and stuff like this. Being an ex-president, the first transgender president, and I'm a member of the NOS National Committee for a while, I've seen at the forefront what it's like to be transgender and being a student at times, and there's a lot of transphobia in there. So I just thought, let's bring in the liberation network. So we have a space where trans people who are under the trans umbrella can come together, discuss what's going on, look at how we can bring campaigns together to change people's perspectives of what transgender really is and how innate we are to society. We're not out there to cause harm to people or anything like that. But there's all this misunderstanding, miscommunication about trans people and who we are and what we want out of life. We've got to realise that there's a difference between the LGB and the T. And, you know, one is about sexuality, the other is about gender. And when we've got a big voice of LGB together, and they are a big voice to create change in society, it's quite powerful. But the voice of the T is sort of quite hidden at times in that. And we need to change that now, and now's the time to change it because there's a big shift to bringing trans out there. We've had cases of gender come out as being trans, so we're talking about it a lot more. If you look around the world, there's a lot of transphobia to trans people. There's transphobia in this country as well, trans people get killed because of it. But we want to be out there and start saying, we're here, we're human, we're not you, we're not going to hurt you, but please understand who we are.
So, would you then say there's been a specific event that's prompted this proposal, or has it been a gradual sequence of events?
It's been gradual. It's been very gradual move, shift politically to where we are now. And that means it's given us that chance now is to have a voice, but not just politically, but locally, is to create change. And our voice, it's time we need to be heard and have our views looked at a lot more deeply and discussed and brought forward into the open so people can learn and understand. So this is probably saying a liberation network. The government has protected qualities that are protected by law, and transgender is one of them. The others are disabled, women, race, and LGB and T. But we want to split that and say, look, LGBT, we love you, and you've got great arguments, and they do affect us at times. Mm-hmm. Then we have two, we have totally different arguments that we need to get out there, those discussions that we need to have, that you really can't talk about because you don't live through that, you know, and it's the same for us. And so we need that space. We need that space so we can go and talk.
So, if these changes were to go ahead, the project, what impact do you see that having?
I think it's a very positive impact to our university as a whole. I've just been writing university policy for the university to help protect transgender students from transphobia and align university from their student experience. And this is what we're there for. It's not just about having a big political voice in the outside world. We need that voice here. We need to have somebody who's trans can actually talk about trans issues, who can sort of talk to the opposite team to guide them in policies that they have to make. So we're understood that, you know, they might say something or do something that doesn't quite fit in with how it would affect trans students. So having that separate voice would be much better than sort of listening to sort of a convoluted voice where, you know, where they're trying to cover everything, but can't really.
Right. Undoubtedly, one of the questions that's going to be asked about this is how would these proposed changes benefit students here and staff? What would you say to them?
The benefit is quite enormous, especially for myself. One thing I don't want to see is the breakup of the LGBT as a social group. It's not about that, because there are many T people who identify as LGB as well. So it's not about breaking that apart, it's about working together, but making sure the T voice is heard in a separate way by and being given to them by only T people. People say, why can't they, you know, have a subcommittee to do it? It doesn't give us the power or the ability to run our campaigns that we need to run with our own voice. You know, we're still all being ruled by another group of people. So having been supported and funded by the student union, working together with LGBT much of the time, we can make sure that our voice is actually heard, and anything that affects transgender people is actually addressed and brought forward. So it is a big, big effect on students.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Any discussion points?
I'm the transgender and non-binary NUS LGBT plus committee rep, and actually at this university I run.
I'm sorry to stop you there. I'm just conscious we may have some people in the room who aren't as over familiar with some of the abbreviations and acronyms and stuff. So
yeah, that's
let's
no worries.
Do you all right?
So NUS is the National Union of Students, and I work with the LGBT plus committee as their national transgender and non-binary rep, non-binary being similar with trans in the regards of its gender identity, but it's you don't fall under male or female, you fall kind of either in between or completely out there. And within the university, we run a transgender and non-binary support group, which, when we learned that this was being brought to the Best Stats Forum, I brought it to our members who, and these are the people it will be directly affecting. And a near complete consensus was that there was a lot of worry that this is going to actually oust them from LGBT+. Maybe not in the first year, but as more years move by, and new students come in, it's going to have an effect that students are going to feel more torn between LGBT plus and trans network, as well as the fact that in itself it's not as welcoming for non-binary identities to call it just the trans network in itself. I mean, that's just pedantics in itself for a name. But a lot of the members who are trans and non-binary have openly said to me they prefer it how it is. They like the idea of the trans network, but they feel that currently they're not at a stage where they feel it would have a positive effect on them. Whereas they'd feel more torn between. So they asked me to sort of speak.
And to voice that. Thank you very much.
And so if you have any questions in regards to that.
Oh, this is a question, this is just another question. I'm a communications officer for the LGBT plus network. And I agree with like sort of what Stephanie said in the video and stuff, it was a good point. But I feel like the separation of like the transgender and the LGBT plus is kind of inevitable in a way. Like it's as much as you say like it's not gonna happen, we're not gonna be separated, we're just going together, it's going to happen and make people who are transgender but also may identify as being bisexual or pansexual or whatever, they'll feel like, oh, which group do we go to then? And it's a bit like, yeah, I just feel like separation is the best one way. And a point that my friend made, who unfortunately could be, is that from this, considering the trans network would be a branch off from the LGBT plus, does that mean that we create branches off of networks for the other liberation networks? So like, for example, does that mean we create, from the multicultural network, do we create a Black Asian minority ethnic network of like whatever other ethnicity or race could fall underneath that?
Can I take from that point, is it a setting a precedence almost? What's the concern around the comparison with other networks?
You spoke about this earlier, and I do agree that it's a worry that by one breaking off, sort of, if anything, related to Brexit, Britain leaves, you know, the EU, and all of a sudden a lot more countries are questioning, do they want to leave? And likewise, a lot of members within the other networks might start questioning, do they want to break up? And if we break up too far, we lose our ability to support ourselves and defend ourselves, as we are, you know, we're minorities, and as liberation networks, we're here to support students, but if we break up too much, we can't really actively stand together and support each other.
Any comments?
No, I agree with what Tobias said.
So coming from a very similar place.
Yeah, yeah. Yes.
Just different concerns.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I think more than ever, like what Tobias said, I think we need to see, like, transgender students, gender variants, do they actually want this? Do they actually like what are their concerns, and then like figure those out.
With that being the case, I feel like there's an ideal moment to bring this up. The very nature of this question is one that I feel can only be resolved through a vote of a particular membership. It's not fair for me to decide what's right or wrong in this situation, nor do I think it's right for anybody outside of the situation to make that decision either. I think we have to be democratically done if anything is to be done at all.
Are you saying that this isn't the place to be making this decision?
I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is, perhaps rather than saying an officer will take this forward, perhaps the proposal should be modified to suggest actually a vote will be taken off set membership to work out whether they want it to be done at all.
Yeah, I
would like to, before I speak, I would like you to speak.
I'm the network manager for LGBT plus, so sort of a little bit of heart issues. So I would say that I would agree with them. It would be a vote. As Tobias said, they have been talking to the people that directly affect. If they're not completely sold on it, I would find a problem if you set up this network and it's not, if it's not wanted, then it will be a liberation network that's set up and then there'll be no support. When it comes to elections, no one will run for the role. As it is, me and Karis were elected because no one else stood.
Yeah.
So I just think if that's the precedent, we should perhaps check that it is something that everyone does want. And I would be far more far more happy to come to my network meeting and say, look, you have a vote. And I'd rather have my members decide on what they want rather than perhaps people who, and I'm not trying to be rude, I'm not, but some people don't have the experience and the understanding.
If, before you showed your hand, my question was going to be to identify how many of the people who are affected by this change are represented in this room today. I think your point is just
as we are the sort of people in charge, we don't have a problem with it. It is just our only issue is if it's not wanted, then we don't want to force something onto someone that makes them feel uncomfortable. So we're not opposing or forwarding anything. We're completely neutral, but we would push for a vote on it rather than perhaps it be put forward.
Please, yeah.
Yeah, sorry, just like to say, again, like Ashton and Chris have been saying, it's not that we don't support it as an idea, because we recently passed a very similar procedure within NUS. We've created a trans conference in the last couple of years. We've now, you know, created our first trans officer who's going to get paid to do this. But having spoken to members at the university themselves who identify and will be affected by this directly, I do feel that if they can have their voices heard on this matter themselves, regardless of which way the vote goes, they'll feel that they had that chance to have their voice heard, and they'll accept it either way.
Yeah, go ahead.
On the subcommittee for LGBT plus networks this year, I completely see where fear is coming from, and I've raised one point, not as a detriment to the LGBT plus network, but we have a very low level of engagement. We have a lot of members, not all of them turn up, not all of them get involved, and many of them who do even turn up are not very politically minded or interested in a political engagement. So this is affecting a very few people. From Tobias's support group, there's not even a dozen people who attend.
Actually, there are quite a few people. You've only attended one session.
The ones I've attended, there haven't been a lot of people, but this isn't affecting a large population of the students and isn't affecting a large population of LGBT plus. We already have certain issues wherein within the community there are certain subtle elements of segregation where people don't understand each other's point of views, don't understand each other's identities. This could worsen that. Although I do understand where Fee's coming from, it would also strengthen the TN plus side of things for non-binary people, because we have more of a voice of our own to actually stand independently without necessarily being overshadowed by anybody else. So I can see both sides of the argument on this. I am somewhat on the fence, but essentially at this point in time, as everyone else has said, I agree it should be taken for trans and non-binary students to be able to vote on.
I suppose, from my point of view, I'm conscious that this is not my decision. Somebody else's. I think it would be irresponsible of me to go, well, no, yes or no, you can't do X, Y, or Z. It's not for me to do.
Yeah, I don't feel comfortable. I don't feel like I have a right to have that decision yet. Not until they've made a decision, it's
not
down to me.
Just a thing more to come. I know that while our membership isn't exactly the biggest, do you remember that we're not just there for our members, but we represent every person under LGBT plus at the university out or at our membership. So while we may only have so many people turn up to the meetings who would be affected by this, it's also every other person that on campus will be affected by this in the coming years that I'm worried about, because we have been every year increasing our membership and engagement in huge strides. So I'm worried, like, 2 years down the line, how this is going to affect.
Yeah, it's definitely having an impact in the long term, for sure, but as it's been immediately in regards to if we put it forwards and start getting it moving, it needs to be put on a stable foundation if we do it. And that would require more people to get engaged with the vote, so we make sure it is more suitable.
Yeah.
Go down.
Can I just confirm the democratic process, if this is put towards a vote? Does the votes, as this is the bench last one, it's for the membership of the student union, does the vote go to the entire student union membership, or will it be delegated to the LGBT plus
community? Entire membership is my understanding.
If the panel take a vote and it's not 75%, then it would go to the membership. But what I'm hearing the panel say is they don't want to take a vote because it's inappropriate.
Based on the information available at this point in time, and if this isn't the arena or the environment to make the absolute decision, very apprehensive from the discussion gone on, and I'll come to you in a moment, thank you. without Fee being here, we can't have a well round. I don't feel everybody present today, we could have the discussion in the round that this merits. So even if this was the right arena, I don't think we're enabled to have that right discussion now. And the panel have already made their feelings verbally and non-verbally about how comfortable we are with this. This being a democratic process, how do we wish to proceed?
If I may suggest, maybe the members could address it in the next network meeting agenda.
Might be also if you could do like a poll or vote maybe on the union website or whatever. Not everybody is like attends the meetings. It's like part of like the membership list. I mean, this because we have polls to that. But I think what would be an idea is like if you do it online, like pre-basis saying, do you like self-identify as trans, non-binary, so like tick a box, and then you can go through to like actually vote on it.
However,
if that's possible.
In terms of the mechanisms and how the information is gathered, that's not driven by this forum, is it? It's driven by the individuals who are carrying out.
No, don't
apologise, because it's great, we're getting an understanding and we know what we need to do, but in terms of what's in the remit of this panel, that kind of wouldn't fall under us.
If they did take if the membership did take a vote, would that be confidential of what every person who voted votes for? Because I know that some members would be worried about backlash.
Fine.
Can
Chair.
We ask Mike?
Because
he's been
person. Yes. Chair, I suppose, how would it work? There's two potential ways that we could work it. We could work it in the same way we run an election on our sort of website system, which would allow us to set up a for and against argument setup, and then you would vote for and you would vote against. We would be able to see who has voted, but you would not be able to see what you have voted for. The other alternative is we do an anonymous survey link, which I suppose is not restrictive like the website is, so we wouldn't be able to restrict it only to students or perhaps to students from, I suppose, certain groupings within the student body. But that would be much less, I suppose, bureaucratic, if you will, because it's just very much a click and you fill out a quick survey and we would just then toss up the scores based on at the end of that.
Does that answer the question, Tobias?
Yes.
So, how would we like to move this proposal forward? I don't feel it's right to put it and to throw it out.
I would just say as a closing comment to it, just for the record as well, should the trans network not happen, it's not to say that we're not going to disregard what Fee is trying to do. Like the concerns of the trans community and plus as well is valid. We're not throwing out because we don't care. It's not because we worry about whether it's wanted. We've had an alternative suggested today that we have a third member of our committee added whose focus is trans plus. And perhaps that's something obviously this is within our own network. It's something we need to consider. But just so the room is aware, it's not something that we're just going to leave hanging. It is something we do intend to keep focused on.
Ben?
Yeah, the discussion around the proposal of the committee subcommittee and the third committee member being a transgender plus representative, that actually has come from conversations with the National Union students and executives and Vice President of Human Development and the Vice President of the LGBT plus male. Richard Brooks and Raoul spoke to both of them about it to see what their suggestions were. Their suggestions from an NUS point of view is that it's working very well on a national level to separate the transgender plus with their own officer, all that sort of stuff, because the representation is high enough to develop at the student union level and our level, with the level of representation there is, to keep the awareness and the strength of the community up. And they suggested keep the umbrella there, but to still have that representation within the umbrella. That is no more than a suggestion, we wouldn't influence the panel in any way.
And the driver behind that, just for clarity, is that on a local level, the representation is so small
yeah.
that it's by virtue of its size, it would struggle to influence. So it's better under the broader umbrella of LGBT plus, as long as the T and the plus feel as though they are well represented.
There's only a suggestion from members of the National
Okay. Just one second, Ben. Val's been waiting at the moment. Val, at the back.
He just technically, he is asking for this proposal to be postponed until the next meeting.
Parked until the next meeting?
Yeah.
Where she would be able to attend?
Yeah, she would be able to attend that one.
From those who have made the effort to attend today from the LGBT network, and thank you for making the effort to attend today. Is that something you guys would be happy with and where we could potentially discuss at the next forum?
The next one's in January, right?
Next one,
next
January.
We could set up a separate forum just to look at these.
If that is what is easier for the panel, then by all means, however.
If I may, Ben, please tell me if you disagree with me.
No, it's fine. Thanks for that, Brad.
If I may, please feel free to tell me if you disagree with this. Would it not arguably give you, and by you I mean the network, enough time to actually establish how you wanted to proceed with this?
What, so thrash it out internally before coming back to us?
That way, at the next meeting of this forum, or as when this discussion gets brought back, there is a unified position from the network saying, look, this is what we want. Whether it's in line or out of line with the proposal at hand is a different matter, but it gives us something a bit more concrete to work with.
So that's fine by us. I mean, as long as, like you said, our main concern is our members at the end of the day. If we can get a voice from them, that we can bring that's even better.
Okay. Any more comments?
If it helps, you're going to get a solid piece of research together.
Thank you very much for your contribution. And all the updates will be online. Thank you. Okay. Fees issue. Fees proposal. Are we in agreement that we're to park it for the next Better Staffs Forum? Yeah, which is send fee to say yes, that's been agreed, that's fine. Lovely, we'll review it then. Thank you very much, and thank you for the discussion and the input as well. Thank you very, very much. Staying on networks, Daniel Donnelly Phillips. It's three separate proposals that Daniel submitted. The first one being that we change our liberation networks to equality and diversity networks. Following on from that, we create new networks for mature students, local students, postgraduate students. And also agree to change the Mental Health and Wellbeing Society into a network. I'm going to go straight to Darren.
Are we taking these individually? Individually? Because we would like to discuss each one as a separate issue.
Yeah, break it down then, yeah. That's fine.
Okay, so first one on the renaming of the networks. This is more just a fact of where liberation networks come from, why the name liberation networks. It is actually the National Union students identified them as Liberation Networks for Student Unions. So the reason that the name Liberation Networks was adopted is because that is what it is seen as in UK-wide within student unions. It is not anyone in staff deciding the name. This has been filtered down into every student union in the country. So this is where the name Liberation Networks comes from. So this is just giving you all a bit of information on where the name of liberation actually came from.
So you feel that that's a significant, it's important to retain? Is that the point of providing that information?
I'm not going to influence the panel.
that I'm just giving.
So you're just what you're providing a little bit of background information so that the panel and the audience can make an informed decision. Thank you. Anything else from anybody else regarding the changing of the Liberation Networks to Equality and Diversity Networks? All lovely. Amber's first up just about, so go ahead.
I'd say in part that it might be somewhat incorrect to call them Equality and Diversity Networks. I think this is especially for what these networks are about, is that in some part it is more equity to create equality for those that are disadvantaged. As opposed to necessarily putting everyone on an even basis, some people already have advantages and a head start. So it's semantics in the naming, but semantics that are important to some others.
And important to you.
Yeah.
Because?
I'd consider myself somebody that would be ineffective.
Thank you.
What is that to have it? Stay or to
change. Say liberation, because I think the term equality, in a sense, isn't necessarily true to the views and the vision of those networks.
Thank you very much. Next.
My thoughts kind of echo Tal's today. I think, we're called liberation because we're trying to, achieve equality, because the liberation networks we have, they are considered minorities or, slightly oppressed groups in it. Called liberation because we're trying to be liberated to achieve equality and all that stuff, yeah.
So would you like them to remain as is?
Yeah, remain as liberation.
Is there anybody in the audience or in the panel who's on the other side of this argument?
What about changing it?
About changing it. Is anybody for the change?
If I might, before we move on. To answer Darren's point in terms of fact-finding, just confirmed with Margaret here. Part of a Liberation Network status is that, unlike any club or society, which requires an elected committee to be able to operate for the following year, a Liberation Network does not require any student membership for it to be carried forward over the years. It is its own self-sustained thing, in the sense it would be like a standing item on an agenda. It's something that was always there, no matter whether it's required or not. Just for information again, not trying to sway anybody.
So if we were to change the name, are you saying that we would lose that additional support?
I don't know how that would work.
I mean,
so
it shouldn't do it. It should be a question of just semantics, but what appearing in the room is semantics are important to individuals.
Yes.
Various reasons.
And I assume those semantics are important because of identification.
I would say if we were in meetings with other universities and at the National Union students, we would end up referring them as our Liberation Networks anyway, even if the name was changed, to make sure that we were in coherent two conversations. So we wouldn't recall them Equality and Diversity Networks or at any conference or meetings outside of Staffordshire University.
Also, you've got to think about the legacy of it. However long the Liberation Network has been going on, you've got to think, okay, what have they achieved over the years they've been the Liberation? If you change the name to Equality, the only thing that they've achieved is the name change.
Mm-hmm.
So, and you have to, as you said, you have to keep referring back to, oh, it was formerly known as the Liberation.
Any other comments from the panel? Anything in support or against Sam's comments?
I agree that Liberation should stay as a communications officer of the Disabled Students Network.
Thank you for that, Nick.
Yeah.
Anything else regarding the changing of the names from Liberation Networks to Equality and Diversity? Does the panel feel as though they're in possession of enough information to make a decision?
Yeah.
Can I have a show of hands if you are in possession of enough information?
Don't really understand it, so I'm going to stay out of it.
That's fine, that's fine. Well, at this point in the process, abstentions aren't an option. So we either have the option at this point of either gathering a little bit more information, ideally that would be from Daniel, unfortunately can't be here, or from somebody else who is informed and with us today.
What do I get?
So,
don't
yeah.
Really understand it.
So,
it's a lot of.
I'm looking for somebody on the. I know our officers can. I'd really like somebody from our networks to help bring about a bit of understanding in our panel member. Aye, Robbie, yeah, dive in.
Essentially,
thank you.
Well, essentially the liberation networks are, there's the women's network, the multicultural network, the disabled network, and the LGBT plus network. We're getting the mental health and well-being is being talked about. They're not like societies in the way that the rest of the union works, that they are more community-based and offer support to these groups that are essentially marginalised people, people who, for example, for transgender people who have social difficulties based on their identity, people who are disabled experience difficulties in life because of that. And if it's just on who they are, their identity, be it choices or not, it's about creating a community to support them. And that it is essentially, the liberation is to promote equality and diversity, but we're seeing that calling it equality and diversity isn't true in some senses, because we're actually trying to achieve that, we're not already there, and equality on, as a baseline wouldn't really work for everybody.
Okay.
So
this group's
That's fine. And I thought that was an excellent explanation and good initiative from yourself in raising that. So, and feeling confident not to raise your hand when everybody else around you was. So thank you for that. Would you like to ask any more questions?
No, it's pretty clear.
Cool. I shall return to my previous question. Panel, are you in possession of enough information to make a decision on the proposal as to whether we should rename our liberation networks, equality and diversity networks? A show of hands if you are, please.
No.
Still don't feel?
Mm-hmm.
How?
No, it's like, I don't know what difference it's going to make being a liberation or equality, because like, I'm an international student, so I feel equality and diversity fits me more. Like, I'm not like talking about, because I know what you talk about being a LGBT or anything. But where I fit in, if I see, maybe you can make it liberation and equality and diversity as a group, because I know being an international student and being, I've faced a lot of racist problem and everything here. So
I can understand the similarity,
mm-hmm.
as in they are the LGBT,
mm-hmm.
in terms of numbers for quite small, particularly if we were to split the LGB, it's when we bring it all together that you have your strength in numbers, and you find yourself in a minority.
We have not reached, definitely, I also don't feel we are equal when compared to any other European or being a British. Anyway, I'm seen as an international student, maybe because of colour or because of anything. So I feel I need equality, so that name fits me more.
The act or fact of gaining equal rights or full social or economic opportunities for a particular group. So it does include equality in the definition of liberation.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. What difference is going to make by changing the name?
So
that's why I don't feel any necessity to change the name. So
That's good. So if you feel as though you're in a position to not support this,
mm-hmm.
your answer to my first question, which is, do you have enough information to make the decision, is yes. But when I ask you, do you support the proposal, your answer to that question is no.
No, that's what I'm saying. I didn't raise that for
the
first answer.
Oh, that's my mistake as chair. I do apologise. Was it just me who got that wrong, or was it everybody else in the room as well? I'll take that one on the chin, and apologies. So, I shall try and make myself clear. I'm asking the panel whether you have enough information to make a decision. Whether that decision be yes to support the proposal, or no to deny the proposal, do you feel happy to make that decision? A show of hands if you do, please.
Yeah.
No.
You haven't got enough information to say yes or no.
Yeah.
So you have.
Because you just said before, oh, no.
No, I'm saying there's no much information to take it to the panel.
Oh, so there's not much information to say yes or no.
Yes.
Okay, that's fair enough. That's fair enough. Well, if we do... we are at a point where we haven't got 75%. Daniel isn't here to provide that extra. What would you suggest, Margaret, if I may reach out to you?
It only needs a single panel member, so there's enough information.
Yeah. There's no abstentions at this point in the process.
Yeah.
So.
Defer it to the next meeting, I guess. But
I'm more comfortable
about what you wanted in terms of the panel.
I just want to know what is the necessity to change the name, first of all. So there is no much information.
Yeah,
so
I understand.
Yesterday,
if Daniel had
been here,
he could have given
us
that, which is why.
I don't know.
Why does he want to like specifically change it?
Mm.
I checked the proposals before coming to the meeting, and one of the statements in Daniel's proposal was liberation from what exactly, as a sort of ambiguous question to say, why are we called the liberation networks, what do we want liberation from? That seemed to be the angle he was trying to make with this. I'd say, as you said for yourself, it would be liberation from racial prejudice because you're an international student. And that's in part what we say we all stand for together as a group of networks.
Mm-hmm.
I'm comfortable parking this one till next time, and hopefully Daniel can be with us.
Mm-hmm.
And it moves us on to the last discussion point anyway. I don't want to park all three elements of it though.
Mm-hmm.
Just the Liberation Network and the change to equality and diversity. I'm going to move on to the change in the mental health and wellbeing society into a network, because you've already touched on that very briefly, and it sounds like there's been some broader discussions. So, Daniel's suggestion is make the mental health and wellbeing society a network. It will show that the students union are there to help all the time, and it will nerve, and it will
never disappear.
Thank you very much. Never disappear, as it already helps with self-care activities on a regular basis. We'll be dedicated to helping students get the best social support as members can meet others of a similar mindset and share their experiences. Every month we're doing an educational presentation which will approach a particular aspect of mental health. During and afterwards there will be opportunities for discussion and a chance for everybody to express what's on their minds. Also, we will be doing self-care activities every 2 weeks, such as walk in the park, art therapy, meditation, etc. Everybody is welcome to join regardless of age, race, gender, etc. And it is our priority to make sure you feel comfortable and safe. If you have any questions, please contact the committee. So that's a little bit about the mental health and well-being. So the idea is to change the name of Liberation Network to Equality and Diversity. You're right, what are we being liberated from? It's about equality and diversity. And he would like to see more networks for mature students, postgrads and local students, as these student groups tend to get overlooked when the uni are planning events. Thoughts?
Sorry, this is on the Mental Health Becoming a Network.
Yes.
I set up the Mental Health and Wellbeing Society last year, and I'm now the Disabled Network Chair.
Mm-hmm.
I think that I love the fact that Mental Health became a network, but then we discussed how we don't want the trans network to separate from the LGBT class. The Disabled Network does support students with mental health difficulties as well. Also, I'm not comfortable having this discussion without the Committee of Mental Health and Wellbeing here, because I know the manager's not here, okay, so I don't think we can even have the discussion without them here. Because they're going to be the ones who will have to run it, and they're the ones. Because I don't know if they all. I think they're positive for it, but I feel they need to have their voice heard.
It might not happen this academic year. It might come into place next year when they do the election for next year's.
Well, still, I think that it should be. They're probably most qualified to be able to discuss why it should be, even for a few years' time.
Thank you very much, Catherine.
I class myself as having mental illnesses, but I do not class myself as disabled. So I technically, personally, don't feel like I'm part of the disabled network, but I do feel more inclined to the mental network. And something that I'd like to further put on, I don't know
but
if people...
because of the way in which you identify yourself, can I read into this that...
There is a separate issue of mental health to disability.
And there's not inclusivity and
yeah.
Okay.
And I think that needs to be looked at by both the managers from both the networks. And I think that's a decision we can't further today. But I'd also like for the managers of the disabled network and for them to pass on to the mental health about the issue of young carers and support for people who do have caring roles and responsibilities outside of their academia. And thing like that, because I think that you can address currently under any of the strands.
Okay, thank you.
I know
much.
That's not. But yeah.
No. It's all relevant. How does everybody else feel? We obviously had the suggestion to park it until we've got some informed voices and people around us. How does everybody else feel about that? In support of? Panel, are you in support of that, or do you have any questions for those who are with us today? Can we park that? So just to be specific, that's the Mental Health and Wellbeing Society into a network and the formation of networks for mature students, local students and postgrads. Thank you very much. The final discussion point, it's not a proposal, so there's going to be no more voting, or at least not at this point. The final discussion point is when we should hold this meeting. In terms of it being a vehicle for change. Oh, I've missed it. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. What I'm going? Not at all. Well. Firstly, I tried to raise the food right item right at the beginning, and I was moved off it. So you were prioritised by the chair, if I can just make that comment. I've parked them all for Dan. So I've parked the creation of mature, postgrad, local, and the development of mental into a network. So all of those would be parked. Sorry, I did summarise it very quickly for Margaret, sorry. Possibly the most important issue of the day.
It's a very important issue, yeah.
The emotion in your voice when you thought I'd skipped over. Well, I had skipped over, I'm sorry.
I've been sat here for so long as well, I've got a crick in my neck, I really need a pee. I need to go search the counter for something I can eat that is chips or fruit or some dried salad.
Well, you've definitely got the empathy of the panel, so I think you're halfway there. After witnessing a vegan student being told only two sandwiches were available to buy from Squeezebox, I felt that now is the time to ask for students' union to do some market research so that Squeezebox can provide to order a greater choice of food to vegans, vegetarians, and us carnivores who will eat most things. We would like the office team to work with Squeezebox and the marketing team to do market research from students and staff who use the venues.
It's not me, it's me. I'm just here to speak up for vegans.
No. is that Ben responding to the contentious carnivore comment?
Yeah.
Is he throwing eyes around? Market research from students and staff who use the venue to see if what is offered is correct and what needs to change, to be changed and added. I recommend that this should take place over the next 6 weeks after this Better Staff Forum so that the office can report back on the following forum at the end of the research. And that's Daniel's words and work. There isn't enough vegan food on campus, and if you are vegan, you may feel forced to go home to eat due to lack of choice. Can we have more vegan options on campus? Kyla Lawton. There we go. So I agree, Kyla's comments. I'm sick of eating the same food day in and day out. There's no choice, and some days I can't eat as there's nothing quick, and I don't have time to wait for food in the Amber Lounge. The soggy sandwich in the shop is beyond vile. And I don't want to eat chips every day. As for breakfast, dry toast and beans seem to be the only option. So we've had a very clear picture painted for us about what life can be like for those on site who are vegans. Any comments?
I've got some stats, we did some research.
Okay. I would love you to read those out.
And the other thing, is this more of a quality of food as well?
It's if you want a salad, there's no choice of salad, you just have to have a dry salad, you know what I mean? Otherwise it's like put chicken on top of it or bacon on top of it and that's it. I mean, and if you go to, it's like the new place that's opened up, it's really good, you know, the vegan bit, you can go in there and it's quick and you can get something. But the chances are that most time, 9 times out of 10, it's like, oh no, there's nothing you can eat. You know, we do vegetarian option, but a vegetarian option isn't a vegan option. I can't, and it isn't for me, it's like I've got dietary requirements as well. It isn't just a case of, it's not just, you know, it's not just a choice for me, it's some things I haven't got a choice, and then that leads me to think that there's not just going to be me, it's not just going to be vegans, there's going to be people who've got like dairy intolerance, there's going to be people who've got gluten intolerance. It just seems to be people are catered for. It just, or just like everybody's been lumped into meat eater, meat eater, everything sort of thing.
I know Jamie stood there to give us some market research that's been done. She looks so good standing there. I'm going to bring Darren in and leave her there for a moment.
Can I just clarify, are we talking about squeeze box or are we talking about altering
campus?
Well, everything is being centred around campus, so I think we are going to be splitting things off a little bit between the SU, because I know what you're focusing on, the SU venues, because that's what the SU manage. So there's a sphere of influence rather than having to go and kind of talk to the university about changing their product offering.
I mean, I did look if it was like a vegan sort of society or somewhere, you know, someone I could talk to say, look, can you put a bit of pressure on the uni to sort of like,
do you want to set one up?
No, I'm all right. I've got two societies I'm trying to juggle already without setting another one up. You know, I'll be honest with you, I just like meet myself coming down.
Okay. Darren has just tried to bring us into a world, I think, where we can really bring about some change, and that's in the SU venues. And I don't know what the market research relates to, Jamie.
So we've got stats from Squeeze and Ember, and then we've got a statement from University Catering, but not stats. So to give you a brief overview, 77% of Squeeze food is vegetarian or vegan, 23% contain meat. So 78% overall, so when you've got your hot food and the stuff that we've stored.
Yeah, but that's 77%. I know where the 77% is vegan and vegetarian comes from. It's all cheese. That's not something.
See, you can ask for anything without cheese.
Yeah, and then you've literally got. I mean, I went in there because the squeeze box used to be really good for me last year because you used to have so many different options. I used to be able to have like avocado and all sorts going on, hummus. Whereas now they said they've sort of stripped the menu back. And when I went in there, it was just like, it was all, okay, it's can't eat, okay, it's got milk in it. A lot, do you know what I mean? It's a hidden dairy that people don't see as well. It's just like, oh, it's just an okay part, it's
gone. That is from a wider complaint from the membership on operationally that the squeeze box is very slow.
It is slow.
And it was slow because of how much choice there was and everything was freshly made. And we've now got some pre-packed sandwiches in there to quicken space up. We've streamlined the menu so that we're not cooking as much. We've got jacket potatoes in there now so that are hot held in. So it was all about speeding up this data service and the customer service and the customer journey, because Squeezebox is meant to be a pop in and go out sort of venue, but there is the option to sit in like a cafe. But it's very much where people go for the morning coffee, so between lectures and things like that. For the membership, we were trying to like streamline the speed of service.
I get that.
So by responding to one set of student needs, we've created or no longer meeting
yeah.
a need that previously we were.
I think you've got that, and then in the same token, you go to like all over campus, and you're just not catered for in the same way as everybody else. So it does come to the point where you do end up just eating chips constantly. I mean, I put on so much weight last year just eating chips here, that to the point where I spent a whole summer swimming and running. I've got a Fitbit and everything now, and I just don't eat anymore. It's like, I can't eat here, I was just waiting to go home. So.
Yeah.
And it's things like, you know, you've got a pizza, like a vegan pizza, it is the most vile thing. If there's even potato on this pizza, you know what's potato on a pizza? I don't get that. Maybe that's just a personal choice or whatever, but.
Well, it's tickle jam. It's tickle jam. Do you want to run through a little bit more of this market research?
Yeah.
I just had an idea a moment ago, and we'll see if we naturally get there.
So, Ember, there's 16 vegan options, 42 veggie and 29 meat. So, from a meat eater perspective, veggie and vegans are doing a lot better than them. And then there was research from the university, and only 12% of students identify as vegetarian or vegan. So, I guess we're kind of stuck with not
but isn't that too. Isn't that then, if you're saying that, you wouldn't have this argument with the LGBT plus network and say, well, there's only 12% of you, so I'm not going to.
Oh, no, of course.
Do you know what I mean?
But
those are the statistics that you get back all the time. It's like, you know, surely, like, just because there's only 12% of us, it doesn't mean that 12% of us doesn't matter. You know, our student experience isn't important.
That's what I'm saying. I'm vegetarian.
No.
You know what I mean? I'm just challenging that. Yeah.
That's excellent. I'd just like to bring in the comments from this gentleman first.
You're probably going to hate me for this. Your stats are including vegetarian and vegan together when the issue is that vegan food is vegetarian food cannot be eaten by vegans. It's good that you've done this research, but it isn't entirely appropriate for the people that this issue is being raised for.
Thank you very much, Sam. You were next.
Sorry. Can I just say, you have it better for us in Ember, and
that's what I do tend to
because they've
Ember.
Got a card where if you buy like 5 vegan meals, you get a vegan meal free, and we don't get that.
There's obviously some focus roughly going in that doubt, so there's some good stuff going on. There's just a little bit of stuff that needs to go on to make it work.
Well, I just replied to your comments. The reason I've included a vegetarian and vegan is that it is actually customizable, that we can take the vegetarian thing that make the product vegetarian and start to be vegan. We can take them out of the actual concoction of the and make it vegan. That's why they're included together.
It's more like, for example, pre-packaged sandwiches.
Yeah.
You can't take the cheese out of a pre-packaged sandwich. So it's what's there on offer that is specifically, doesn't have any prep, any interaction with it, you can hand it to somebody and it is vegan food.
Yeah, you wouldn't sit and pick the cheese up.
So the two vegan sandwiches in the shop.
The
vegan salad.
They're not. I've eaten them. They are so watery that they're just not good at all. But it's, you know, I just kind of would like to be able to, you know, just be able to, if, you know, like the salad bar, be more of an option on the salad bar, if you know what I mean. Or like, if I just have like a vegan curry, you know, just, I know I can get that. There's a go-to sort of healthy option as well, because it's like, you know, if you look at like these options, how many of them actually have the options? There's a lot of chips involved. There's the vegetarian burger in the Ember. It's all fried. It's all like, you know, you don't want to eat that every day. It's just not. I mean, I like chips, like veggie burgers, but not all the time. It's just really not good for you.
That's lovely. Thank you very, very much. I'd like to come to the young lady there.
I have 2 points. One, agreeing with you, being both vegan and gluten intolerant. The sandwiches, of course, won't be suitable, and all gluten-free sandwiches have egg in or tend to. And the other point is, I think there just needs to be a bit more understanding among, for example, people working in Ember. I've ordered vegan options of things, and they've put cheese on it, and then got really confused and judgmental why I was having to take it back, and like, oh, can't you just eat it with the cheese on? I'm thinking, well, I'm sorry, and then obviously I feel really bad for ordering the food.
Could you give me a time of day when this happened? Because Monday to Friday during the day, we have kitchen managers in both venues' kitchens, and they are fully kitchen trained and have the experience, so they should be very much able to identify what of vegan, gluten free. We do have all the options there.
It was taken back and replaced, it was sorted, but it was just the comments that got, so I just thought, you get sort of judged in a way.
Are you picky?
Yeah. People just assume you're really picky and being difficult, and you get, obviously you can't control the whole staff's views, but you should not have people making comments at you for being.
What sort of comments?
Just like, oh, she's just being picky, or she's like, it's like I'm making their job harder.
Did they say that to your face?
May I? Because one thing I think I want to comment on, Darren, from an operational perspective today, and his understanding and some of the solutions he's come up with, I think he's demonstrated that he really understands what goes on around here, and that's excellent. And that kind of question there is trying to get down to the operational standards within some of our venues, and I've had some conversations there, and the changes that we've made in Squeezebox, simplifying the menu off the back of the feedback, in the main, that's working really, really well, but we're not always going to meet everybody's needs, and I think the university acknowledges that, but that doesn't mean that they're not going to try to, I can assure you of that. I'd like your conversation to be taken offline outside of the forum if you can, and if you need to ask some questions and find out, and then it'll get dealt with. That was very relevant. Thank you very much for your input. In terms of, I want to come back to Jamie's research, because I don't think we've really got to the end of that in terms of what's currently provided, and then start to look at a solution. If all the efforts are coming in from the university and the union to provide this, but the people receiving it don't feel like they're getting, there's a mismatch, and it's often just a case of bringing people together and bringing them on a level,
and
then we'll start to get it right.
Say, for example, if I'm based over near the library and I want to nip into the, I know this isn't part of the student union, but I'm just saying that, as a student union, you are our voice for the university as well. So if you go into the cafe, there is nothing in there I can eat apart from popcorn or a fruit shaker. There is no salads, there is no sandwiches, it's all cakes full of dairy, egg. There is absolutely
the salads in there have egg in, don't they?
They have egg, or they'll have feta on, or, there is literally nothing. And sometimes you need to have some sort of choice, because sometimes you haven't got the time in between lectures to go running from one place to another, trying to find food, because you think, well, I can't go there, but I'll check there. The Ember Lounge is the best place, I will say that, I'll give it that. That is the best place to get food, and that's my place of choice. But you don't always want to eat the same thing, if you know what I mean. And it is a very sort of like fried food based menu. And
Thank you.
It just like, ugh.
No, that's look, thank you very, very much. I'm just conscious a little bit of the time.
Yeah, but if
I've cut you off before you've had the opportunity to say something, then please do. Jan?
Yeah, so this isn't like the final research we're done now. That's not. It was just some stats to give you. But we can look into it more. Keith, the manager of Squeeze, is looking into more vegan options. So with his next coffee order, he's bringing in a vegan hot chocolate option. And there'll be a soup of the day as well, which will always be vegetarian. And he's trying to make it vegan. So he is looking into it. I think
Is it a homemade soup of the day? Because literally every single vegetarian soup doesn't need to be made with anything that a vegan can't eat. If it's made from scratch, you don't
know. He's purchasing it in. But he has got vegan spreads and stock soy milk and coconut milk as well.
I mean, maybe it's worth setting up a meeting with one person, Keith and yourself, to get that, because I think we're working on what we think you want rather than.
So are we almost moving towards a steering group for the venues?
Yeah, that will help.
Sorry, is it Kyla?
Yeah.
Kyla Lawton, yeah.
Can I just stress that? Speaking of the quality of vegan options and pre-packed sandwiches and things like that, is that maybe something you would like me to take forward to the National Union of Students Director of an Oversight Board so we can speak to our supplier about the quality of service that we're receiving?
There's someone
who wrote that. So, in terms of the initial proposal, I feel like we're already to a point where we've agreed and we're kind of moving forward and we've kind of bypassed the panel and the tick in the box. But I don't know whether I'm allowed to do that to the process, Margaret.
Ask the panel.
Thank you very much. Panel, are you in possession of enough information to make a decision on whether we will explore improving the vegan options available on campus, specifically related to student union venues in the first instance. So it's narrowing the proposal a little bit.
Although, can I just say, it's part of the research the officers did. We approached the university, and the catering manager was open in respect of acknowledging there wasn't a vegan option, and did say they would consider it if there was the demand. So we can bring some influence to bear there if there is demand.
The thing is, with a vegan option, it's not just vegans that can eat a vegan option. Anybody can eat in a vegan option. I have a family of people that eat meat who eat my food. I can't eat that. That's vegan. I'm allergic to vegan food. It's not just vegetables, So.
Listen to this, what you said earlier. Before I went vegetarian, I actually used the meat-free car because I figured out, and I think they changed the terms and conditions because of this. I'm bogged off burgers when I have my car full. I'd get two burgers for one to get my index stamp, and then redeem that stamp for another two burgers. So always giving four or three burgers for one stamp. I wasn't even vegetarian at that point.
Who was doing that?
I did that last year at Stafford.
That shouldn't have been happening because there's those voices weren't meant to
be. It happened.
I told you it was on it, didn't I? I told you it was on it with the venues.
Yeah,
okay, lovely.
Even if you eat me, you have access to that food as well.
No, very good point. Very good point. So, panel, are we in possession of enough information to make a decision on whether we should explore improving the vegan options on site? Show of hands if we do. Thank you. And if you support the proposal for Jamie, our president, to take this forward with the assistance of Kyla, potentially form some kind of steering group. Do you support that proposal, panel? Show of hands if you do, please. Lovely. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Take that forward.
That was with you, Jam. So we've had a nice split of some of the actions from today as well. I'm conscious we've all been in for 2 hours and we've had some involved stuff and we've had some times when Kyla's just sat here for an hour and a half and just listened. Daniel put a discussion point forward around the time that we arranged these meetings and as to whether we would get more engagement or they should take place at a different time of the day. Darren, of course, has an opinion, but I'm going to ignore that hand for a moment. I'll go on, statement, let's go. I can't ignore that.
Our statement is on this item is that we, as a user, we do put them at different times in the day because of the Better Stats Forum having at different times. We'll never meet everyone's schedule, so the reason that we have alternating times for starting is so that we get a variety of people and we get different schedules involved in the Better Stats Forum. Because obviously there's people that won't be able to attend at the moment, but if we do one at 4 p.m, there may be people that have scheduled from 4 p.m. till 6 p.m. that would not be able to attend then. So this is with why we have the alternating start times for Better Staffs forums.
Thank you very much for that, Darren. Comment I just made to our panel member there, is carers, for instance. So, in case anybody heard me murmuring between ourselves. Any other comments or thoughts about it? Advantages to putting it at a different time of the day? Advantages to varying, as is the current approach? Well, it was just a discussion point. It's nothing for us to vote on. And if we don't want to discuss it, then that brings this Better Staffs Forum to a close. I'd like to thank the officer team, all four in attendance today. So thank you very much for that. Representation from the LGBT+ network. And everybody's input today, everybody's put a proposal forward, Nick and Sam. Finally, our panel members, thank you very, very much.
We would just like to thank Alex for chairing the
Thank you.